160, 5 days ago Harry and Meghan delivered to Oprah Winfrey a damning indictment of the Queen's beloved royal family, including accusations of racism, as her husband of 73 years lay dying in hospital. Just 33 days after that interview, Prince Philip passed away, plunging the 95-year-old monarch into mourning for the man with whom she had shared her life. Despite contending with one of the most difficult periods she'd ever experienced emotionally, Harry and Meghan's largely fanciful and unverified claims were not simply dismissed by the Queen as I believe they should have been. Instead of spending precious time with Philip, the Queen gathered with courtiers to carefully ponder and then release a statement responding to the interview designed to take the Sussex's claims seriously but not throw the rest of her family under a bus given the complete lack of proof provided to a sycophantic Oprah. She said, "The whole family is saddened to learn the full extent of how challenging the last few years have been for Harry and Meghan. The issues raised, particularly that of race, are concerning. While some recollections may vary, they are taken very seriously and will be addressed by the family privately. Harry, Meghan, and Archie will always be much loved family members." The Queen also agreed to spend one-on-one time with her grandson when he returned for the Duke of Edinburgh's funeral, even though I'm sure she did so through gritted teeth. And by that time the royal family had agreed to the appointment of a diversity czar, another attempt to show the Queen took modernizing seriously. But was that enough for the most self-obsessed duo on the planet? Of course it bloody wasn't. After months of relentlessly attacking the royal family but claiming they weren't targeting the Queen, Harry and Meghan seemed to be setting the attack dogs on the most respected woman in the world once again. The couple's author Palomid Scobie will deliver the criticism on their behalf in an updated version of his hagiography Finding Freedom, Co., written with the TV producer Caroline Durand, which comically paints the fame-hungry man, eating D-list actress Meghan as a modern, day Mother Teresa. Scobie, who has spent the past couple of years acting as a junior PR officer for the couple rather than a credible journalist, has provided an extract to Meghan's favorite fawning magazine People that is published today. He writes of the Queen's statement, "Those three words, recollections may vary, did not go unnoticed by the couple, who a close source said were not surprised that full ownership was not taken. Months later and little accountability has been taken," a pal of Meghan's added. "How can you move forward without that? What the actual hell? How dare they? The Queen does not need to take full ownership of anything she didn't do," and the couple told Oprah it wasn't her who made a comment about their as yet unborn baby's skin tone. And until Harry and Meghan provide proof of racism, Therese, nothing more the Queen can do apart from talk to her relatives, which she has already promised. Now I know how Scobie works. He's an operative for his beloved. The idea he would quote sources close to the couple without knowing the Sussexes approve of them is laughable. But hilariously today the legally trigger, happy Duke and Duchess of Sussex have unleashed their Rottweiler lawyers' shillings to try and scare off journalists connecting Finding Freedom to the couple. If they're so horrified, then why don't Harry and Meghan publicly condemn the book, given they're so inclined to do that about other media coverage with which they're unhappy? After all, the publishers have even decided to release Finding Freedom Part 2 on August 31st, the anniversary of Princess Diana's death. Anyone who knows how all the behind-the-scenes dealing between journalists, royals and the Sussexes work, which I certainly do, knows that this book is published with the silent approval of Harry and Meghan. Scobie admits to speaking with the couple's close friends and associates, something I doubt would have happened without their permission. And remember, Meghan adores Scobie so much that she invited the bloke to her last official day at Buckingham Palace, where he wrote a fawning account for Harper's Bazaar. While the criticism of the Queen is the most incendiary aspect of the new version of the book, not surprisingly, Prince Charles and William are not left unscathed. In an interview with People magazine to promote the book, Scobie added, "There are people within the family who, the Sussexes, are much closer to today than they were a year ago. But in terms of Harry's relationship with his father and brother, that progress has been very little. I think he is quite willing to own his part in everything, but I have been told that he is waiting to see some of that on the other side, and as of now, there hasn't been that. I covered Harry and Meghan's tumultuous time inside the royal family closer than any other journalist, culminating in breaking the story of Megxit. I didn't pick a side, my job was simply to reveal the truth of what went on. In fact, contrary to popular belief, I was very supportive of Meghan when she joined the monarchy and believed she had so much to offer. But very sadly, the truth doesn't mean all that much to this couple, and disinformation, an issue they claim to be passionate about, is spread at an alarming rate by their allies. When I asked Meghan's dad Thomas on my GB News show last week if she had told the truth to Oprah, he responded immediately and unequivocally, saying, "No, she lied, she lied. She's been lying for years. She's been lying on and off over different things for years. Had she always had the capacity to lie? No, no, this is new. This is since Harry," Thomas added. "I don't know if he's the one behind it, but I really think that Harry and some of her friends have changed her. I love my daughter, but I don't always like what they're doing. Now find me any evidence of the Queen lying during her decades on the throne. I know who I trust." The new book by Scobie concludes, "As difficult as recent years have been, sources close to the Sussexes say that neither Harry nor Meghan have any regrets about the decisions they have made. What started as a fairy tale romance became a story that reinvented the genre, a self-made, independent woman playing an equal role alongside her knight. Pass me the sick bucket." All the dishonorable duo have achieved by allowing their inner circle to collude with this author is heaping further pain and pressure on the grieving queen, and that's nothing to be proud of. Those involved with Finding Freedom 2.0 should hang their heads in shame.